Okay, let's wait another 10 seconds or so. Okay, I think we can start now.
Okay. Yeah?
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the NITEP mini school on classical and quantum chaos. My name is Francesco Petruccione, and I will briefly introduce you again to today's speaker, Dr. Dario Rosa. Dario is based in Daejeon at the Korean Advanced Institute for Science and Technology. And last week he started the mini school by giving us a very nice overview and introduction to classical chaos. And if I remember correctly, today he will start speaking about the more quantum aspects of chaos. Yeah. And as per last week, Dr. Sinaisky will again moderate the questions. So please, if you have questions or comments, please use the Q&A facility at the bottom of your Zoom window, and Ilya will collate the questions and pose them to Dario in a coherent fashion. Yeah. So Dario, please, thank you very much for being with us again from South Korea, and we are very much looking forward to lecture number two of your mini school. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah, as Francesco said, today we will start to move to the quantum regime. So we will start our trip in the quantum realm after discussion that we had last time about the classical regime. So and in particular, we will focus on this concept that I will introduce in more details later today, which is the concept of level repulsion, which, as we will see, can be considered as a sort of smoking gun for the presence of chaos. All the time we will see level repulsion, we will be on the right track to say, okay, quantum chaos is at work. And today we will introduce this notion. But before that, I will start by, let's say, talking about the problem of quantum motion. Motion is in quotation for reasons that will become clearer in a second. And in particular, at this stage of the lecture, we will learn that developing quantum chaos is a highly non-trivial problem, and actually is a problem that goes back to the early days of quantum mechanics and somehow is still under development right now. So it's really a problem which is hard to solve. Anyway, we will see that the problem of the quantum motion can be traced to the notion of trajectory and to the unitarity property of quantum mechanics. So after reviewing the problem, we will tell something about symmetries, because this will define for us what I will call the universal ensembles, which is some universal, families of quantum Hamiltonians, which are labeled by symmetries. After that, we will go to the core of the lecture, which is the notion, as I said, of level repulsion, which we will say that level repulsion is really in one-to-one correspondence with quantum chaos. So we will introduce level repulsion, and I will try to convince you that this is really the relevant notion in order to talk about quantum chaos. And in particular, this will constitute the starting point for what is called the BGS conjecture, which will be the subject of the next lecture, next Tuesday. And then if we have time, in opposition to level repulsion, if we have time, I will say something about level crossing, and we will say that level crossing is a signal of integrability as opposite to chaos. This part I will probably be very sketchy, and I will just say a few words, and I will try to convince you in some way, because the main topic will be this. This is just sketchy at the end if we have time. Okay, so I think we can start. Okay, so let's see. So as anticipated, now we will start with the problem of quantum mechanics, of the quantum regime. And to start with, let me remind from last lecture that classical chaos is based on the following notion. We talk about classical chaos by saying that our trajectories are highly dependent on the initial conditions. So the idea is that we have a point and we start with a certain P. So we have P and X and we start a trajectory. This is our trajectory. And the idea is that if we move a little bit, we do a small modification delta X and we start a new trajectory, the new trajectory will be completely different from the other. I should start with the same P, so maybe I start like this, but then the motion drastically changes, so I have very large differences at late times. So the notion of classical chaos is related to an high dependence on initial condition. This is essentially, if you want, the essence of what we discussed last time, which brought us to the notion of Lyapunov exponent and so on and so forth. However, let me remind, this is high dependence of the trajectory to the initial condition. Now, in order to study the trajectory, we need to know x of t and p of t, because we need to know for each moment, at each time, we need to know very well the position and the momentum of the particle in order to predict the evolution of the particle at a later time. However, we know that in the quantum regime, talking about trajectories doesn't make sense at all, because we have the Heisenberg principle, and we cannot know with very high precision both x and p, because there is the undetermination between the two. So essentially, if we know with very high precision x, we know nothing about t, and so about p, and so we know nothing about the velocity, or vice versa. So in other words, the notion of trajectory doesn't make sense at all in the quantum regime. So this explains us that classical chaos is incompatible with Heisenberg. So this is essentially the main reason why the road to quantum chaos, so if you want, going from classical chaos to quantum chaos, is a hard problem. It's hard. Why? Because essentially we don't have, a canonical or a natural way to go to the quantum regime. Okay, so this is the situation. We have a problem and it's not very easy to solve. Now, we could try, as usual, if you have questions, please interrupt at any time and we can discuss. So, at first, one could try a first attempt, which is wrong. So I describe this attempt is the naive attempt, the poor man attempt, which is we turn out to be wrong. But anyway, the first attempt that we can think is the following. We know that classical chaos has to do with the sensitivity to the initial condition. So one could say, oh, let's try this. I take a quantum Hamiltonian, so I have an Hamiltonian. I have an Hamiltonian that I call H, which is my operator, my Hamiltonian. Then I could say, I'm smart. I pick a state. I pick a state and I call it psi. And pay attention, psi is not an eigenstate, is a state, but not an eigenstate of H. And then I deform, I mean, I want to mimic the classical idea. So what I do, I deform a little bit psi. So my psi go, let's say, to psi prime, which is equal to psi plus, let's say, something that I call delta psi, with the property. So if you want the property that I want, is that, let's say, psi prime modulo square is equal to 1 minus delta, where delta is very small. So the idea is that I do a small deformation of my state in such a way, in this way that I wrote, and then I could say, okay, so how it evolves C of t. So I can define this quantity C of t, which is nothing but this psi of t, where psi of t is the evolution of psi prime of t modulo square. So I could ask, okay, how this behave? And I could think that this is a natural way to mimic the classical situation to the quantum regime, and I could think about this quantity. However, it's pretty easy to recognize that the evolution, the time evolution, operator is u of t, which is, let's say, our time evolution operator built out of the Hamiltonian, u of t has the property that it is unitary. So essentially, u of t is an operator such that ut u dagger t is equal to 1. So when I do the time evolution here, I pick a u dagger from here, a u from here, they give 1. So essentially, ct is 1 minus delta again, and it is completely time independent. So let's say d of ct with respect to time is equal to 0. So this is telling us that this idea, which looks natural and looks very much inspired to the classical intuition, cannot work because of unitarity. So unitarity and the notion of trajectory says us that there is not a very simple way or a natural way to go to the quantum regime. Actually, one thing which I will not discuss today is the following. Let's say in the last 5 or 6 years, something like that, maybe more. Anyway, more recently, it turned out that one can have better chances by following a similar idea with operators instead of states. And this led to the notion of out-of-time order correlators, OTOC, which are nowadays pretty popular in the physics literature, especially in high energy, and for their connection to quantum gravity and so on. So this is something that we could, okay, let me say, the third lecture will be about the BGS conjecture. Instead, about the four lectures, next time we will do a poll, and I will ask you if you want to hear about this story, so about how we can somehow define an alternative notion of chaos based on some intuition from the classical chaos and based on operators and define the OTOC. This is one possibility for the four lectures. Or otherwise, we can remain in the realm of the BGS conjecture, and the next time we can discuss some recent applications of quantum chaos to condensed matter. These are two possibilities that you will decide what we want to hear in the last lectures. Anyway, today I will not talk about this. Maybe we will discuss in another lecture. And today, my goal would be to define an alternative notion of chaos, which have better faith and give better results than this notion that didn't work at all.
Sorry, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
So the question is a little bit provocative. Are there evidence that quantum chaos exists in the first place?
Well, let's say it this way. We should decide what we define to be quantum chaos. What I can say for you is that we can find, let's say, throw level repulsion, we can find evidences that all the quantum system, which the classical counterparts are chaotic, they share similar features and they share the same feature of level repulsion and the agreement with random matrix theories. So if you want, talking about quantum chaos is more like a creativity moment than, you have to define what you mean by quantum chaos. In some sense, it's a definition. So if you want, the status of the conjecture is the following. All the systems which, having a classical counterpart show very similar and very, how can I say, coherent features, which bring us to define quantum chaos as these coherent features among them. Did it answer?
Okay. I think that the idea is we still don't know what the quantum chaos is. So according to the definition which you are going to advocate today, we have some indication of the chaos. According to the OTOC criterion, there might be also some other systems which demonstrate chaotic behavior. Because one is just going to look like on, for example, average values of position. And of course, you can find turbulence in some vortices in the Bose-Einstein condensate. Yeah. And probably over there, according to OTOC, one can also find chaos.
Yeah, but there are, anticipating a bit, the relation between the notion that we will develop today and next week and the OTOCs is still unclear. And there are debates in the literature in which people say the two notions are not in one-to-one correspondence. There are systems which are chaotic in one sense and not chaotic in the others. So this is a field under development at this moment. Let's say that what I'm going to discuss today and what we will discuss next time received an enormous amount of experimental confirmation. So is on a firmer ground. On the other hand, the OTOC point of view is much more natural once to develop the necessary theory. And so this tension, of course, is one of the main points that we would like to clarify in the research today. So there are recent papers which argue, does scrambling and scrambling in the physics of the OTOC equal chaos? This is the title of the paper, and they argue no. There are other papers that say, maybe that is just a minor difference, which is not affecting so much. So it's really a topic under development your question is perfectly meaningful in that sense.
Okay, it was not my question, it was a question of Camille, and he's following up. In the sense that from what you said, okay, can one conclude naively that the chaos does not exist in the quantum regime at all?
It's a matter of definition, right? I mean, you have systems which are unequivocally chaotic in the classical sense. And so you would like to define the notion of quantum chaos in some sense. And as I said, all the evidences suggest that all the systems whose classical counterparts are chaotic have the same features. So,
okay.
If you want, you can call this feature in another way. You can call it quantum and choose another name. Quantum chaos is because all the systems that have this feature are chaotic. So in the classical regime, you can call it in another way if you want.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, good. Okay, so now we start let's say a technical detour by talking about the relationship between symmetries and universality. Okay, so first of all, let me start with a small preamble. Now, assume that we have a symmetry operator R. By symmetry operator R, I mean that we have H commutator with R equal to zero, and R dagger R equal to one, such that R is unitary. And so we know from quantum mechanics that R defines a quantum number . So the idea is that we can go from eigenstates of the Hamiltonian with a certain energy E, we can go to states which have definite numbers under the Hamiltonian, and R, let me call N the quantum number associated with R. I'm assuming here that R is a discrete spectrum. So now the first point that I want to emphasize is that when I have this situation, my H can be decomposed in blocks. What I mean is that my H can be written in this way. I have H1, H2, and H3. So it takes a block diagonal form in this way, dot, dot, dot. And all these blocks have definite value of n. So let me show this, that each block has a definite value of n. So let me take a generic superposition, which I call n generic, which I take all the, I take a linear combination, over EI, in which I take alpha I and I. So the idea is that I take a linear combinations of states which have all the same quantum number n, fixed and generic. And so I can study this guy, H, R, acting on n generic. And since all of them have the same quantum number, this gives me n generic, so the value of n that they have in common, time H, n generic. So my time H that acts on my linear combination. On the other hand, if I take R H over N generic, if H is not in a block decomposition like that, this is different from N, if you want, is different from H R N generic, which means that RH and HR fail to commute with each other. So this means that you have to be in this situation, otherwise this possibility doesn't apply. So we know that all the time that there is a symmetry operator, I mean, that my system has a symmetry, my Hamiltonian decomposes in this form, H1, H2, H3. And so, to study level repulsion, which will be our main focus, level repulsion is a property of the single block. So essentially the lesson, let's say H1 of the single blocks, H1, H2, H3, and so on and so forth. So the idea is that in order to see level repulsion, otherwise level repulsion will be lost, we will not see it, is important to recognize all the symmetry operators and do the maximum decomposition of the Hamiltonian in all the possible blocks, then pick a single block and study it separately. Otherwise, we will not see this property. Essentially, we might say that under a symmetry operator, essentially the system split in several systems, each of them independent from each other, is like to take two systems and just put together, but they don't interact with each other because the off-diagonal terms are zero. So in order to study the quantum chaotic properties, we need to focus on a single block. This is a very important step. And so I will always assume that essentially I did the decomposition in which all the quantum numbers are found, and I study a subsector in which all the quantum numbers except the energy are fixed. So essentially I need to work with fixed quantum numbers, except, of course, E. Okay, so this is an assumption that I have to do to see level repulsion, otherwise I will not see it. And now, so this was the preliminary, and now I want to talk about another symmetry, which is the most important one in order to define the universality ensembles. So I assume that I already separated into all, let's say, the quantum numbers defined by the symmetry operators that I have in my spectrum. And then I discuss a further symmetry that usually is not taken into account in this decomposition, in this block decomposition, which is, let's say, the time reversal symmetry. So this is a discrete symmetry that just flips the sign of the time. And this is very important because essentially the universality classes are defined in terms of the properties of the system under the time reversal system. So to define, to study the time reversal symmetry, let me start by considering the Schrödinger equation. So my Schrödinger equation is this, IH dt of psi as a function of x and t equal to h. I'm assuming that h is just a function of p and q, so it's not, I'm assuming that I have autonomous systems, so h is independent on time. So h of psi of x and t, so this is our situation, and the time reversal operator is an operator t that, of course, what it does is that t.
Sorry, Dario. The Hamiltonian of the p and x, not p and q, yes, because your x is coordinate.
Sorry. Sure.
Sorry.
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Absolutely. So t of f t is equal, by definition, to f minus t. So this is our time reversal symmetry. And so the left-hand side, LHS, flip the sign, flips under under t because of the derivative with respect to time. So I change the sign. Well, it can change or not depending on the behavior of psi, but suppose that psi is invariant under time reversal. So this guy changed the sign. This guy doesn't, because H is autonomous, so this doesn't change. And so it remains that this cannot be a symmetry by itself. So or vice versa, is if psi change the sign, it will change also here. So here I don't change the sign, here I change. So in any case, is preserved, doesn't change, so we can say that C, T acting on...
Sorry, Dario.
Yeah?
Can you please repeat the thing after the change in the sign and how you go from the time reversal to the CT? Because at least for me and for Francesco, you were frozen.
Ah, okay, yeah. What I said is that under time reversal, the left-hand side change sign while this guy doesn't. So in order to have the chance to have a symmetry, I need to compensate this change by promoting the time reversal to the CT, which is the complex conjugation and the time reversal, such that this guy doesn't change. And I have hope that I can define a meaningful operation on H such that I have a symmetry. Is it clear now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so what I'm presenting here is this IH. dt ct is equal to ih dt. So this is a symmetry for the left hand side. And so what I have to study is the property of, so what I need to study, I want to study the property of ct commutator with h and see what I get. In particular, again, H is autonomous. So concluding, what I want to study are the properties under complex conjugation of H. So my problem now, the problem that I want to study, are C H commutator. Okay? Okay, so there are three relevant cases that we've got to discuss. The first case is that, so first case, C is not a symmetry for H. So in this case, I can consider it as an example. So let's take an example. And as an example, I take H equal to 1 over 2m P minus E over C A square plus V of X. So this is the case of an Hamiltonian in which I have a particle in a magnetic field. So in this case, let me remind, P is equal to I over H nabla. So in this case, this operator is complex. So in particular, I have C of H different from zero, so C is not a symmetry for H. And so let's study what we can conclude by this. We can simply conclude, by definition, since H is the Hamiltonian, H is Hermitian is an Hermitian matrix. This is by definition. However, H in general is not real in general. Of course, suppose that I diagonalize H, I can find a proper basis in which H is real because the eigenvalues are real. But in general, if I take a random base, I will get H, which is not a real matrix in general. So in this case, so the case in which, let's say, C, H different from zero, in this case, the symmetry group, I can study which transformations over H preserve the property of being Hermitian of H, and this is the largest symmetry group that I can act on H in order to preserve the Hermitianity, which is the only property that I have, because I don't have any reality property. So in this case, the group of transformations that I can act, so the transformations are unitary. So in this case, my transformation that I call A, I have H prime equal to A H A dagger, and this is a unitary matrix. Okay, so we learn that in the case in which H is not invariant under complex conjugation, I have a matrix which in general is not real, and the symmetry properties of my Hamiltonian are preserved by any unitary transformation acting over H in this way. Okay. Now, and this was the first case. Now, as a second case, suppose that we have the situation in which, so second case, in which C is a symmetry. So in this case, I have, so let's take, and in particular, let's suppose that there are no spin 1/2 interactions. So I have, an H, an Hamiltonian, which is like P squared over 2m plus V of X. Now, in this case, my Hamiltonian is perfectly invariant under C. Okay, so in particular, I can find, so in particular, since I have this property, I can find a basis that I call phi n, which are eigenfunctions of C, and in particular, since they commute, I can build the eigenstates of H, so I can build the matrix H in terms of these eigenfunctions. Notice, in general, phi n, so I'm not diagonalizing H, I'm just picking a basis made of eigenfunctions of C, so made of functions, so since that these are eigenfunctions of C, I can say that phi n are all real. I could even say that they are purely imaginary, but in any case, I can always redefine my functions in order to be all real. And so on this basis, I can take this basis, and on this basis, which is pretty generic because they are just eigenfunctions of C, so they are just with definite reality, But I have the property that on this basis, H is real. So essentially the message here is that all the time my H does commute with C, I can pretty easily find a representation of H in which H is real. And so in this case, so this was the first case we said. Now the second case in which H is real, in this particular case, in which C H is equal to zero, my transformations that preserve, so I want to preserve both the Hermitianity but also the reality, so the transformations are orthogonal. So they are matrices that I call O, such that O transpose O is equal to 1, and so my transformation acts in this way. H prime is equal to O H O transpose. And this is the second symmetry group in which I can easily find a real representation for H by its reality property under C. Now we still have 20 minutes and probably I want to rush a bit because I want to go to level repulsion. So let me skip the third case. Let me just mention it without details. So the idea is the following, that third case. Okay, in this case, I consider matrices in which H contains, H has spin 1/2 interactions. So in this case, in this particular case, my H turn out to be a matrix, in the spinorial representation. So essentially my H becomes something like H zero, one, this is the identity matrix in 2x2 plus HI, sigma I, where these are the Pauli matrices, because I have a spin 1/2 interaction. So generically, my Hamiltonian take this form. And now it can happen that in this representation, H0 and all the HI are real. And this is what people call a quaternionic real matrix, because as a spin 1/2 interaction. So on top of the full matrix, there is a tensor product with other two by two matrices in the spinorial space. In this particular case, I can define when these are real, I can define a new charge conjugate operation that do a charge conjugation on these guys and do an operation on the Pauli matrices, such that I can define a new notion of charge conjugation, which I call C prime, such that my C prime H is zero. And in this case, so I can define a new notion, if you want, of reality. And in this case, the symmetry transformation become like sigma S H S minus one, where S is a symplectic matrix. The idea is really the same. It's just a bit more convoluted because I have to consider also the space of the spinors, but the idea is really the same. And these are the three symmetry classes, the three main symmetry classes, which are defined by the symmetry properties under charge conjugation of my Hamiltonian. I have the unitary, in which I don't have any notion of charge conjugation symmetry. I have the orthogonal, in which I have, let's say, the naive notion of charge conjugation symmetry, in which my H is independent, is real. And I have the symplectic case in which I have a spin 1 over 2 interactions, and I can define a new notion of charge conjugation under which H is invariant, and the symmetry properties are controlled by the symplectic group. Okay. Now we can go finally to level repulsion. So, to discuss level repulsion, the idea is the following. We notice that if we just take the classical intuition about chaos, we fail, because the classical intuition about chaos is about the dependency on the trajectory, and we know that this is not a good definition. However, we can be a bit less, inspired. So we can take, another message that from the last lecture, we had another message. So let's take last lecture. We know that chaos is the generic situation. And integrability is the exceptional case. And this is the proper setup to define quantum chaos. So, we tried first to take the maximum possible intuition about classical chaos based on the trajectory, and we failed. So we tried to be a bit less ambitious, and instead of take the full message of classical chaos, we take a less ambitious message where we learn that chaos is the generic situation, while integrability is the exceptional case. And so, in order to develop quantum chaos, we need to look for generic properties of an Hamiltonian. So the idea is that we don't want to do, so this is the hallmark of quantum chaos. We don't want to do any fine tuning. We don't want to do any very specific assumption. We want to look for generic properties shared by most of the Hamiltonians. And this will be the hints of quantum chaos that we are looking for. And the most, as I anticipated, the most important generic feature is level repulsion. Okay, so to introduce this, let's introduce this notion. So to introduce this, we consider two closed energy levels, E1 and E2. These are two closed energy levels. And we want to study how do they change when, so the question is, if you want E1 as a function of lambda and E2 as a function of lambda, we want to study how do they behave where lambda is a parameter. So the idea is that our H is defined in terms of a parameter, and we want to study the fate, we want to study the dependency of two closed energy levels, E1 and E2, as a function of this parameter lambda that we vary. Okay, so let's study this problem. using nearly degenerate perturbation theory that we know from quantum mechanics. So when two levels are very close, we can somehow forget about all the Hamiltonian and just study the restricted problem to the two energy levels. So we do perturbation theory. So we have two levels, which I define be one and two, which are the vectors. And so I define a two-dimensional effective problem in which my H turn out to be H11, H12, H12 star, H22. So this is my effective problem in this regime. And I want to study how the energy levels vary as a function of lambda, my parameter that I want to tune. Okay, so this is a pretty simple problem. So I can study the approximate eigenvalues are E plus minus 1/2 plus H12 plus or minus square root 1/4 H11 minus H, two square plus the modulus of H12 square, everything under square root. So these are my E plus minus. And the discriminant of this guy can be written in this way. So the discriminant D is equal to 1/4 is this guy. So H11 minus H22 square plus, of course, the real part of H12 square plus imaginary H12 square. Okay, good. So now, this D, let's take the unitary case. So unitary case. D is the sum of three pieces larger than zero, all of them, positive, positive, positive. In the orthogonal case, we know that this is zero, because in the orthogonal case, my H can be taken real. So I have two pieces, both larger than zero. Now, if we are in a generic situation, I'm talking about generic situations. I'm not talking about any fine-tuning situation. In a generic situation, I have three pieces or two pieces which, in order to be the discriminant zero, must be both equal to zero, and I have just one parameter to fine-tune. Now, the generic situation will be that the distance between the two energy levels can be certainly minimized, but it cannot be equal to zero. The discriminant equal to zero by just playing with one parameter when I have three or two pieces that both should be equal to zero. And this is the essence of level repulsion. It's a very simple concept, but has far consequences. So what I learned is that in general, In general, I have what is called level repulsion. D can be minimized but D in general will be different from zero. So the typical situation that I have is that as a function of lambda, and here I put E, I have E1, E2, and by varying lambda, I have typical this situation in which I can minimize my distance, but the crossing is avoided. This is the generic situation, and it is the hallmark of quantum chaos. By the way, so this is what people in the literature call avoided crossing, because somehow the levels can become very close, but they cannot cross because essentially I don't have enough parameters to put all the discriminant equal to zero. By the way, an interesting exercise that you can do as an homework is to show that the orbits in this plot are hyperbolic. Okay, still a few minutes. So the lesson is that in general, the unitary case has three pieces and the orthogonal has two pieces. Let me just say that in the symplectic case, I have five pieces, all of them greater than zero. So in all the cases, I can't make a cross. I always have level repulsion. And moreover, I can expect that in the symplectic case, the level repulsion will be stronger, in the unitary case will be in the middle, and in the orthogonal case will be weaker because I have five pieces, three pieces, two pieces. So this is the simplest to make it zero because I have just two pieces and one parameter. This is in between, and this is the strongest in avoiding level repulsion. Now, this argument can be made more quantitative, and this is the last thing that we do today, by making more precise the level repulsion. And essentially what I want to do is to show, let me erase the blackboard. Let me just keep this because we need it. So in particular here, I can define a notion that I call codimension, and I call N. And so in this case, I have n equal to 3, in this case, n equal to 2, and in this case, n equal to 5. So I can introduce the nearest neighbor distribution. Which I call P of S, which is the probability that, PS is the probability that two nearest levels are at distance in energy S. Distance S. This is the definition of PS, the probability that I have two nearest levels and they are at distance S. And what we're going to show now is that PS, so the probability to have a distance S, goes like S n minus 1, where n is the codimension that I introduced here. And so in particular, P of S for s going to 0 is equal to 0. So this is the essence of level repulsion. Okay, let's see the argument. Let's see the argument. So let's take a given spectrum. So I have an Hamiltonian, I have diagonalized it, I have my spectrum. And so on this spectrum that I have, my PS is this. Delta of S minus delta E, where delta E is the spacing among levels, and the average is taken over the spectrum. Okay, so this is the quantity that I want to evaluate, and I know that delta E, which is the discriminant that I wrote in the previous blackboard, the delta E can be written as a square root of x1 square plus plus xn, where n is the codimension, square. So an average over all the possible delta E can be translated as an average over all the possible x1, x2, xn with an appropriate weight that I don't want to take. So I remain generic, is unknown. So essentially, this means that PS can be translated in the following integral: dn of x, w of x, delta of s minus square root of x square. So this is my new formula, in which essentially, instead of averaging over the spectrum, I average over a certain distribution for the various x with a weight. This is my weight, on which I don't want to commit, because essentially I don't need it. I mean, in order to show this property, I don't need it. Essentially, the reason is very simple. I simply define x prime equal to x divided by s. And so by this redefinition, my PS simply become s n to the n minus 1 integral of d n x prime w x prime s delta 1 minus square root of x prime square. And so as long as w of 0 is finite, this becomes a finite number. So essentially PS, when s goes to 0, becomes proportional to s to the n minus 1, which is the property that I wanted to show. Okay, so this somehow ends up the lecture of today. So we have learned that if we just take all the intuition from classical chaos and we try to export it, we fail because the notion of trajectory is ill-defined. However, if we take, less ambitious program and we say, no, let's take from the last lecture, let's just take the message that chaos is the generic situation and we look for generic properties of Hamiltonians which don't require any fine tuning and any particular property, we discover that level repulsion is always there and becomes stronger and stronger, more the codimension increase. And so we say that this is the main feature of quantum chaos that somehow is generic enough to describe all the situations which are chaotic. And okay, let me just mention it, if people are interested, that using the so-called torus quantization, which is an appropriate method to quantize an integrable system in which you have F integral of motions suppose that you have a finite dimensional system with F degrees of freedom, and suppose that you are integrable, so you have F conserved quantities, you can use torus quantization, and in that setup you can show that in that case you have level crossing. So essentially, by varying a parameter, the levels start to cross. So you can show the, if you want, you can show the vice versa of the story. You can take an integrable system, and just by doing torus quantization, you can show that level crossing is the standard phenomenon in integrable, in the quantum counterpart of systems which are classically integrable. And next time, we'll take this as the starting point, and we will look for a theory which reproduces level repulsion, and we will discuss the BGS conjecture, which somehow will define for us what we mean by quantum chaos. As I said in the last lecture, we have the right to choose, so you will have the right to choose. We will do a poll. One option will be, as I said, to try to develop an alternative notion of chaos based on operators and based on the notion of Lyapunov exponent again. So somehow we will have a revival of the first lecture by trying to introduce the notion of Lyapunov exponent in quantum chaos, defining for us by defining the OTOCs and the notion of operator growth and so on. A notion which is still under debate, so probably there will be many developments in the next few years, hopefully, on which I hope that many of us will contribute. Otherwise, we can remain on this setup, and we can discuss some recent application of quantum chaos to condensed matter problems like many body localization and other interesting phenomena in, let's say, in strongly coupled many body systems and so on. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
So yeah, thank you very much, Mario, again, for a fantastic introduction to the topic. And Ilya, sorry, I jumped in too quickly. Before I ask you to moderate the question, I just wanted to welcome on the panel Professor Jeff Murugan, who's actually the cause that we are listening to Dario's lectures, because he's working together with Dario. And he suggested Dario as a lecturer for this course. So Jeff, thank you very much for being with us today. Ilya, now I leave it to you.
Okay, so just a simple practical question for me, just to help people to understand. You get s to the power n minus 1 because you get 1 s under the delta function, and when you take the s from the delta function, you get 1 over s, and that's why you get s to the power n divided by s. Okay.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. And there is a couple of questions. Let me read them carefully. So
you said I can see Nick Kim questions, mm-hmm. right?
Yes. Yeah. If you do, you want me to read them?
So let me read. I mean, Nick Kim is asking. The first question is: you said integrable systems allow us level crossing. In your general arguments about level repulsion, which steps do become different in integrable systems? The short question is that when you study, the short answer is that when you study the codimension of the discriminant and so on, typical integrable systems have n equal to 1. So in that case, my s n minus 1 become s to the 0, so become finite. This answer is not satisfactory at all. So let me try to give you a more satisfactory answer. If you want, in this setup, you will see, because when you study the discriminant doesn't have many terms, have just, let's say, one term, and so you can make it vanishing. The way to see it in torus quantization is more or less the following, that if you go, let's say, to a action angle variables, the spectrum can be deduced by, let's say the spectrum is given in this way. I mean, suppose that you have, let's say, two Let me think. Suppose that you have a system with 2 degrees of freedom. Okay, so yeah, so okay. Suppose that you have a system with 2 degrees of freedom. Essentially, the spectrum is defined in terms of a lattice equally spaced. And so on and so forth. Now, the typical situation when you draw, so you define a lattice equally spaced. Now, when you draw a E equal to a constant curve in this space, you get a curve that typically, encounter just one point. So this is the point that you encounter. So this is the configuration that lead to this particular energy. However, configurations passing through this particular point, there are many, and by varying a parameter, by varying our lambda, you can easily create another shape which encounter another point. And so in that case, you get two states with the same energy, and that is the level crossing. So this is the result of torus quantization. And again, in the setup that we described, essentially is just because it's not something that you see, because essentially our discussion was about generic, and somehow integrable systems are really the opposite of being generic. They are rather special. So each integrable system is special in its own way from the setup that we developed. So the only way, I think, is via torus quantization that we didn't develop. Now, the second question is the following. If we know a system is integrable, it is practically useful. For example, one can try to formulate exact spectrum based on integrability. Now, if we know a system is quantum chaotic, what is its practical importance? Okay, good. Its practical importance, I would say that this could be one of the topic of the last lecture, if you choose the applications in condensed matter. Now, the idea is the following. Quantum chaotic systems are satisfying what is called a universality property. The idea is that you prepare your state, for example, your quantum state, and then you let it evolve. Okay, suppose that you prepare a state which is not an eigenstate of your Hamiltonian, and you let it evolve in time. Now, this state will have an evolution initially dictated by the Hamiltonian that you have and the very specific feature of that Hamiltonian that you have. However, after a transient of time, all the dynamics, and if you want, all the physics, will be described by random matrix theory. So in that sense, you got universality, like your physics somehow lose the memory of the initial conditions of the specific properties of your Hamiltonian from which you start, and you can get an effective descriptions, and you can do predictions in terms of random matrix theory, which is a rather general theory on which you have very much control. So this is of practical influence, for example, in condensed matter, because many, how can I say, quantities, physical quantities after a transient of time are described by random matrix theory. So you can get predictions which match well the experimental data or let's say the numerical data, or that's it. So let's say that it is useful because you can use universality to make predictions. Is it, Minkyo, are you satisfied? In case you are, please put a mark or something on the chat. Okay, thanks. Yeah.
Good.
Perhaps I can ask a question?
Yeah, please, just go ahead.
Okay, so this is in some sense a follow-up to Minkyo's question. I was hoping you would answer the second question with quantum batteries, but okay. Maybe you come to that a little later. So here's a question that kind of follows up on what the previous question asked.
Yeah.
If you take a hydrogen atom in a magnetic field, mm-hmm. then this is a rather interesting system because it interpolates between integrable and chaotic. And in fact, mm-hmm. it interpolates in a rather interesting way. If you turn off the magnetic field, you have the hydrogen atom, which is of course integrable. And if mm-hmm. you turn the magnetic field right up, then you have effectively a Landau level system, which is also integrable. And it's only in the mixed region in between for intermediate values of the magnetic field that the system becomes chaotic. And you can check this in the Poincaré surface of sections, for example.
Okay.
And it's a quantum chaotic system.
Okay.
How do you see, you know, it would be an interesting system to revisit with these new tools that we have to study quantum chaotic things. Because it's an old problem, which, you know, people were studying with old tools way back when. But how would you see the level repulsion working there as you turn up the magnetic field?
Well, I think you should see something like that. I mean, so as you said, let's say, okay, this maybe we don't need. I mean, here I put the energy levels. And here I put the value of the magnetic field A. So here I have all the energy levels. So when, as you said, when A is very small, the system is integrable. So probably you start to see many level crossings, something, I don't know, like this, then like this, and so on. Then probably you have an intermediate regime in which the level crossing disappear and somehow the various level, I mean, can go very close, but then they repel, and then something like that, probably. I mean, yeah. And then you can have probably another region in which you start to see again level repulsion. So probably you might see something like that. I don't know if it is inspiring the plot, maybe not.
But maybe I can draw for you the plot, and next lecture we can start with that plot, and we can discuss starting from that. And then we can go ahead.
Sure, thanks.
Yeah. Okay, there is a question by Camille. Do we have an idea about how classical chaos emerged from quantum chaos? The answer, I think the short answer is yes. There are many semi-classical works starting from Berry, and Gutzwiller, and many other very good scientists. Unfortunately, I'm not an expert at all about that. So at this moment, I can't say more than just read the literature that I also don't know. But I will do my best in order for the last lecture to be a bit more precise and say something more about that. I know that is a beautiful piece of literature, but it's also an hard piece of literature, and I always been scared by that, and I always said, okay, when I will need, I will study, but for the moment, I skip. And now probably that moment is coming because you are asking. So yeah, I promise that I will do my best in order to do something by the end of the lecture. And yeah, I promise to come back to your question. And if I will fail, I promise that I will come back to you directly, and I will try to explain what I learned. But for the moment, I can just say that there is a bunch of literature about that. Sorry.
Thank you, Dario, for the commitment. Yeah. Thank you very much.
No, because I know, I mean, is the problem is that it's one of the topics which are beautiful for sure, but they are old. And since research go fast, you always say, okay, I will postpone to a later moment, and then you postpone forever. So it's good that somebody asked me, because I will try to do it. So
the moment came. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Ilya and Jeff, are there more questions that you would like to ask or that the participants want to ask?
So far there is none, but can I ask a question?
Because yes. You
If I understand you correctly, that in this kind of definition of quantum chaos, you don't have, I mean, the quantum chaos means that you don't have level crossing. And isn't it particularly useful for example, for numerics? Even if you cannot solve the problem analytically, you can develop, I don't know, perturbation series. And afterwards, you know, if the perturbation series failed, you can treat it as asymptotic series. But I mean, you can, because in the moment when you have a level crossing, many of such methods fails. But I mean, if I'm in generic situation which is chaotic according to your definition, that's much better news than whatever I could, than kind of integrable situation.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, let's say that all these let's say statistical studies of levels and their behavior are pretty, I mean, if you want is the vice versa. I mean, unfortunately, there are very few tools in order to study quantum chaos analytically, at least not in the semi-classical regime. But on the other hand, it's a problem that can be handled in several ways by numerics. Let me also say that what I said before, I mean, the fact that once you have a symmetry, your Hamiltonian decomposes into blocks, and you have, in order to study chaos, you have to focus on one single block, that allow often to turn your problem from infinite dimensional to finite dimensional. So you have all the tools of finite dimensional, let's say, linear algebra, in order to diagonalize your Hamiltonian at finite numbers and see the statistics. So yeah, so is a topic in which the numerics can be very useful, definitely. Yes.
Okay, okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, then if there are no more questions for Dario. Dario, thank you so much.
Thank you.
For the second very interesting lecture. And you hear that from the question that it raised lots of interest and puts pressure.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, it's really welcome.
For the challenging questions. So thank you very much for that.
Yeah.
And I would like to thank Ilya for moderating the question. Jeff just had to leave. Thanks to him as well. And thank you to the participants. And we will see you again next week on the same time, on the same Zoom link. So
let me just say to the audience, think about the two proposals, because next time you will have to decide for the last lecture what you want. So think about it and let me know. And yeah, the last lecture will be about what you prefer.
Yeah, we will organize a poll for the next lecture. And sorry, I wanted to mention also one last thing for the participants, that after the last lecture, so in 2 weeks' time, we will then do a little test, a little quiz for the certificate of participation. So just keep following closely and don't throw away the notes that you take during the lecture. Yeah. So Dario, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much.
A good evening in Korea. And we will see you again latest next week. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.